If I tell you about earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? Words of our Savior, the Gospel lesson for today's Holy Mass, this weekday of the Easter season. I'm not going to get into the born from above, born again thing because it's obvious. Anyone who's studied music knows that from the top or from the beginning means also again. Okay, so we get that, right? It's both things. It's a new birth, but it's also a birth that goes back to the origins and to the source. So I said I wasn't going to talk about it, but I did really briefly. So, but here today, you know, in these strong seasons in the new lectionary, we have this embarrassment of riches with the readings. There's just too much in them. And you look at it and you go, my goodness, you know, how is anyone going to comment on all of this? And you don't have to, of course. But let's just say that there is a deep connection between the community of believers who are of one heart and mind and who called nothing their own but had everything in common. And these are not religious. These are not nuns. These are not monks. These are just Christians, all right? That's a radical proposition that we flee from a little bit as we go, well, that doesn't really work, you know. Maybe it worked in the beginning, but not now. So there's this aspect. These were married people. They had wives and children, families, and they sold their properties and held everything in common and lived in a community. I mean, it really is true. It's not something we can explain away. But there's a deep connection between this particular model, the original model, and what our Lord says to Nicodemus about being born from above. What is it? Well, the key is where our Lord says, if I tell you about earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe if I tell you about heavenly things? Well, earthly things doesn't mean bad things. It just means things that are of this earth. And what's more of this earth, in the good sense, than marriage and procreation? The union of man and wife and their procreation and education of children, that's something of this earth. And it's the way in which we pursue, most of us, hopefully, in our culture now, you can't even say that anymore, but in any case, most of us, that's how we pursue the ways of God in our own particular life. But our Lord gave a general invitation to give up everything and follow him. He says, no one who doesn't can be my disciple if he's not willing to give up everything for his sake. And he didn't address that just to Carmelite nuns. We like that. It's very edifying and lovely to think of the nuns behind the grill and giving up everything for Jesus. But you know, religious have material lives too. They have families. They have to accumulate property. They have to pay the bills. They have to feed people. They have to get them to the doctor. There isn't any difference from the material point of view. The difference is from the point of view of the individual who sacrifices a married life in order to give him or herself to the contemplation of divine things, or the contemplation of divine things and the preaching of the fruits of that contemplation to the faithful. Right? That's the only difference. But the fact is that our Lord calls all of us to the practice of the evangelical counsels. And as I've said before, at least on one occasion here, to be a parent and a spouse is to practice poverty, chastity, and obedience in the most rigorous way, right? There's just no doubt about it. I mean, the evangelical counsels that the Lord invites us to observe, those things are definitely there in marriage. Because in a sane view of earthly things, which is what our Lord is talking about, you know, we accumulate property, what, for our spouses and for our children, not for ourselves. We accumulate property to give it away, to bestow it on others. We don't call anything our own. Does a father of a family say, no, this is mine, you can't have it? You know, in the end, he's perfectly willing to give it away as long as the child's going to be okay. Now, the problem is, since the onslaught of divorce and contraception, people get the idea that, well, marriage is just about, you know, two people having a great time pursuing their original adolescent desires to hang out with members of the opposite sex and have a nice life. And maybe you get a child as an accessory along the way. And then you create a model of earthly things which is perverted and evil, and which creates children who are as evil as their parents. amassing wealth for themselves, hoping that, well, I'll have one kid and I'll make sure my retirement is great because that kid's not going to take care of me. He wasn't trained to. And so we have the culture that we have right now. But if we believe our Lord about earthly things, which means to give up everything for the love of Him, then we can believe about heavenly things, because the children we bring forth, whether in the flesh or in the spirit, are precisely those who are meant to be born from above. Christian marriage is for the education, procreation, and education of children for the worship of God according to the rite of the Christian religion. That's what St. Thomas says. Now that sounds kind of cold, you know. Oh my gosh, you mean I'm just bringing forth children so they can go to Sunday Mass? Well, actually, yes. That is, you're bringing forth children so that they're capable of receiving divine gifts which will lead them into eternal life and to a happiness beyond the accumulation of wealth and trials and sorrows and miseries in this earthly life, to the happiness which lies beyond. We have to prepare our children to recognize that if they have possessions, they have to share them. And what's the first thing we teach kids? Share. That's a basic evangelical teaching. I mean, the fact is, what's mine is mine, and in strict justice, I don't have to give it to you. But if we're Christians, we know that we can't call anything our own, and we have to be willing at any point to drop it and to give it away for the good of others. So our Lord's teaching regarding this lofty reality of our heavenly birth and our rebirth from above by the power of the Spirit has everything to do with the way in which we pursue our earthly lives, and that has to do with seeking the good estate and the security and the education and the possessions of our own children. And everybody here knows that. If you've got a wife and children, you know that, you know, nothing really is yours in the end, and you have to be willing to pick up and go wherever you have to go in order to pursue the interests of your family. And so the cleavage between the life of the evangelical councils and the ordinary life of the Christian is a false one in the mind and in the feelings of Christians, because in point of fact, that has to do only with states of life, but not with the spiritual reality that undergirds all serious Christian living. And so let's put our trust in the Savior that even if we're not monks or nuns, and even if we never even wanted to be, because it's perfectly fine not to want to be, and it's like, you know, we can handle that, that you still are called by the Lord to give up everything to follow Him and to call nothing your own and hold it in common. And when you use your means for the support of those who depend on you, you are basically putting your means at the feet of the apostles, because the church is what you brought your children forth for, and the church is governed by the apostles and their successors for the sake of the sacraments, whereby they are reborn to an eternal life for which their natural life was the necessary condition and preparation. So let's give praise to God that He's abundant in His gifts, and He is not stinting, and He hasn't created several classes of Christians to whom He gives more and less according to their greater or lesser accommodation to some ascetical ideal, because the generosity of the faithful who live in chaste marriage with their children is certainly to be compared with even the most deep generosity of the most ascetical religious. To Him be glory, the Lord, now and forever. Amen.